What up, guys? Fighting Therapist here, and for today's video, we're going to talk about damn Shin Splints. The ouchy stuff when you run. Before we start the video, guys, please subscribe, hit that notification bell so you guys do know when these videos come out. Trying to give you as much content as possible. So, shin splints, what are they? What did they happen? What causes it? Why are you still suffering? Who knows, honestly. In the literature that's out there, there's not really much describing why shin splints happen, but from talking with a lot of supervisors, from seeing it happening, and also just by understanding why it actually is occurring, a lot of the reasons is due to instabilities and lack of strength in the glutes, but as well as the foot itself. Now, when I've treated patients in the past during my stage and I've challenged their strength and corrected these issues that they were having and instabilities, the shin splint seemed to go away. A lot of the things that I've learned later on in life is shin splints I've seen happen a lot with individuals that do a lot of heel running. So they place a lot of shear on their heel. Now that can either go all the way up and drive into their back, to their sacrum, into their hip, and as well as their shin. Now, it's not a direct correlation. I'm just saying what I've seen happen and just kind of cue everything. And a lot of individuals that do a lot of heel striking tend to not be very strong when it comes to their foot stability and strength. Take it or leave it. I'm just saying my experience with individuals that have complained to me about shin splints. So, little diagram of what's going on and, you know, my shittiness and artistic skills. Talk about the shin. We got the tib, we got the patella. We got the space where you get your ACL, your PCL, LCL, everything like that, right? So we got the fibula and we have the tibia. Now in between this space right here is your interosseous membrane, which is pretty much a sheet that connects both the bones together. All these little green things that you guys see here, they're muscles, okay? You have your tib ant, your extensor hallucis longus, your extensor digitorum. Now the shin splint is where you're gonna feel it on the medial side. So people call it shin splints, but the, let's say, therapist term, physiotherapist, is medial tibial stress syndrome. And this is where you're gonna feel a lot of the pain. Now, depending on the person, it usually does happen on the lower one third of the ankle. Sometimes it can even go up to mid tip, but generally it's kind of lower than that, it's never higher. And I've actually had these when I was a kid, and it was due to the fact that I was just running improperly, and I didn't have a lot of foot strength, which is very surprising because I did a lot of martial arts and I was always on my feet and my toes, but my feet were actually like planted and I had flat feet. And later on from school and everything, and I've started to strengthen them and actually fix it, start firing my glutes, I tend to not have any of those pains anymore at all. And it's because of all these rehab and prehab exercises that I'm doing. And we're gonna go through them today. We're gonna start with a simple one, and it's just going to be massaging the area. Now, because medial tibial stress syndrome is an inflammatory issue that's gonna happen, right? If you're getting pain, we're also getting inflammation. So doing some type of massage to the tissue around that area and getting that lymphatic system to pump is going to help. So the first exercise is just gonna be a simple tissue release. Now you can do this with your hand, you can do it with a foam roller, you can do it with your fingers. I'm doing it with my fingers. I'm doing both parts. So I'm also rubbing, as you guys can see on my fingers, I'm rubbing on the interosseous membrane, so the space between my tibia and my fibula, and I'm also rubbing all the musculature on the medial side of my foot. Now, a lot of them are very close together and interconnected, so you're probably gonna be rubbing your tib post, your soleus, your tib ant, the extensors, but just massaging that area upwards and downwards. The reason I like to get the interosseous membrane is because the lymphatic system actually, like, if you look on an anatomical structure diagram, a lot of it is kind of interconnected in between there, so releasing a lot of that tension there and those adhesions are actually going to allow more fluid motion between your tib and fibula, and actually it's going to help with the normal just rotations that occur when you're walking, running, anything like that. So a simple massage to start everything off is always going to help quite a bit. After you get the massage done, first thing that we're going to do is going to be a simple isometric hold, but as well as walking. Now, because we're talking about medial tibial stress syndrome, we also wanna start training the tib ant. And a lot of the times, just holding that position and walking like that could be quite challenging. So the first one is called heel walks. So you're just gonna lift your toes up and you're gonna walk certain amount of distance one way, certain amount of distance the other way, and you're gonna repeat this process for a couple of sets, always gradually increasing the length that you're going at. And then the next one, we're gonna just go on our toes, and it's just gonna be tippy toe walks. I'm gonna walk and really try to drive our foot into the floor and lift us up as much as possible, back and forth, same concept. The next one is going to be, we really actually want to target the tip end. And when we do dorsiflexion and inversion, that's gonna very much target the tip end. We're trying to strengthen those muscles as well, because we're assuming that there's a weakness somewhere along that chain. So doing some dorsiflexion, banded, gradually increasing it, time under tension, eccentric, harder band, et cetera, et cetera. If you wanna keep challenging that motion as you start integrating it into your protocol. Right after you're done that, we're gonna do a tib post calf raise. Now, it's a lot different from just calf raises. It kind of looks like a curtsy while you're driving up. And the main purpose is to put something in between your two heels. It could be a ball, it could be a tennis ball, a golf ball. I didn't have anything outside, so I grabbed my sandal. And what you're gonna try to do is you're gonna try to squeeze that object together, which is gonna get you to kind of do a little bit of a external rotation at your feet. That's gonna activate your tib post as you drive more upwards. And then you're slowly gonna allow your knees to bend a little bit and open them up. You're going to very much feel it right here. More than in just the calf, you're gonna feel it on that medial place, because that's where your tib post goes. And tib post plays a big factor when we're running, and the arch support in your foot. So we really wanna make that a priority and strengthen that as much as possible. Right after you're done this, again, we wanna stretch out the tissue as much as possible. I personally like doing a downward dog stretch because I'm able to really feel it in my calf, but as well all the way up the chain. Now, if you are a heel to toe runner, this is actually gonna be really great for you. Now, on your flexibility, you might not be able to get your heel down, it's okay. When you gradually incorporate this into your routine, you'll notice that you'll become more flexible and more flexible, because your body's gonna start adapting to the pattern that you're asking it to do. Once you've done that, simple calf stretch on a step at your house against the wall, either or, stretch that calf out. We really wanna make it relaxed. Again, when we're not utilizing the other muscles are gonna have to work even more, and later on, if we just continue that, we're just gonna keep hurting ourselves or increase chance of injury. And then the last one is to focus on your arch support. Now, since we activated the tib post before, I like to do this exercise last, and that's creating an arch in your foot and just going for a lunge. Once you become strong with that lunge, you can actually start walking through. So in the video, you just see me go down and up and lift my knee. That's because I'm working on a gait pattern. So when you guys are running, that's what gait is. You're not just lunging that low, but you're coming down with that support on your foot, and then you're driving the knee forward. So I'm just practicing that motion in this static position. So I'm coming up. Later on, you guys can lunge down, come up, step forward, go with the other foot, make it more of a sport specific focus of an exercise. Now, those are all the exercises for today's video. I hope this helps you guys a lot, and I'll be coming out with more videos on this topic, maybe some more exercises for you guys as well. On my Instagram, I am posting a lot of rehab and exercises. So if you guys want, you guys can follow me on Instagram. The links are down below. And you can also follow my therapist page, which is The Fighting Therapist. Either or, if you're following me, subscribe, like, everything like that. You're gonna get as much content as possible. If you guys have any questions, let me know in the comments below. Maybe an injury that you have that I can actually cover, let me know down below. I'll gladly help as much as possible. But that's it for this video, guys. Catch you in the next one. It's your boy, that's Zach. Punch, headbutt, elbow.